Thanks very much for inviting me this morning. It's a great honor, and I'm going to give my presentation in English, but I'll try to answer your questions in French.
FEVAR with physician-modified stent graft to see by 3D printing. So most of us are confronting with this complex aortic pathology. They are most of them high-risk patients when they presented in an acute settings. You can hear perforating. You can see here perforating aortic ulcers. You can see here symptomatic thoracoabdominal aortic aneurysm. You can see here mycotic aortic ulcers after endovascular aortic repair. Of course, for those high-risk patients, we have also endovascular solutions. Like here, you can see custom-made fenestrated or branch stent grafts manufactured by different companies. You can see also these two different techniques, like parallel stenting approaches, like the chipneys and sandwiches, or another option, physician-modified stent grafts. Well, those procedures, they have cons and pros. You can see here the commercially manufactured CMD devices. They are not suitable for our urgent cases, like as rapidly expanding AAA symptomatic contained ruptures due to the long manufacturing time of these special stent grafts. For the urgent settings, the chipneys techniques or the parallel techniques will be suitable, but we don't have a good patency of reconstructed vessel, and sometimes, as you can see here in this case of us, you can have endoleaks, which is in a contained rupture or free rupture. They can be fatal for the patients. Sometimes we can also have to treat type 1 endoleaks that it's not so easy to do. That's why an alternative from this patient would be the physician-modified stent grafts. This solution, it's not new. You can see here the first three very successful cases were presented in 2006. But for the moment, there are very few studies that are available on PM fenestrations. I have found here the latest meta-analysis published 2015. They compressed studies, 15 articles between 2001 and 2015. Almost more than 300 patients were treated. Third of them were emergencies with a very large aneurysm diameter in both arms, physician-modified and off-the-shelf cohorts. A lot of target vessels were included, the same number in both cohorts, and major advanced events were very similar in the two cohorts. So if you look at the success, the technical success after implantation of physician-modified stent grafts versus off-the-shelf custom-made devices, you can see it was pretty similar, 91%, 95%. The mortality was 3.2 in the physician-modified, 1% aneurysm-related versus 0 in the off-the-shelf devices. And the overall vessel patency was 96.7 versus 97.1. So altogether, when we look at this data, we have similar patients cohorts, but we have very similar technical success, very similar mortality, and very similar target vessel patency. So as a conclusion, what we can take from this meta-analysis that basically the physician-modified stent graft in these patients behave similarly to the custom-made devices. That's why we started this program in Leipzig in 2015, and you can see here we have began with 4 patients per year, then we dropped our cohort, and then this year we have included 10 patients in this cohort. So altogether we have 19 patients, and you can see here all of them very sick. We have ASA classification 4-1, 3 16s, and 2 patients who are ASA 2. The indication for treatment in our case was contained rupture in 6 cases, in symptomatic aneurysm in 13 patients. We have pretty large aneurysms treated, 72 millimeter in diameter. And you can see here those aneurysms extending from type 3 thoracoabdominal to juxtarenals. We have treated as well as aneurysm, as well as spouse and suture aneurysm. We had also a hostile abdomen patient. Very to underline, we have not treated any elective patients with this graft. Well, when we started this procedure in 2015, as I told you, and the first 2 years we had pretty difficulties to measure the devices and to plan the procedures, because we had available the 3D measurement software, dimensional software we use it. And here it's the first graph you can see here on the big stand graph, a lot of points that I placed in order to mark the fenestration. So it took us half an hour almost to place the fenestration. After we placed the fenestration, we have sewed our markers, we sewed up the crop, so we were all good to go. But it took a long time, and the accuracy was there, but not always perfect. So we were thinking, is there another method to improve this planning? And we heard about the 3D printing. There was a 3D printer in the hospital, so we said, why not using the 3D printing to facilitate the planning of our cases? We have searched the literature. I found only two publications by that time. That was one from the US group. When the 3D aortic model was proposed as a strategy to eliminate the problems, but in a phantom aorta, basically they used a phantom aorta in a CT scan, and there are another two teams that use this model, but not clinically based. So we have developed our method, and I will show to you what how we started. Basically, after performing a 3D angio-CT thin sliced, we have used a special software to reconstruct the images, looking at the origin of the visceral vessels, ciliary trunks, SMA, and renal arteries in all our cases. Then we marked, as you know, with the planning software, the aneurysm, the pathology here, a drug abdominal pulse. After the 3D reconstructions of the aorta and those vessels, we have started to perform the segmentation. We have removed the vessels. We have let only the orifice of the vessels in the aorta, and we have created 3D mesh. On this 3D mesh, we have smoothened the aortic walls, and we have let the aorta only one millimeter wall. Then we have sent this special STL file to a 3D printer, and we're using special resins. We have printed this aortic model, which is hollow. We sterilize the aortic model, then we bring it in our operating room. We place the stent graft inside the hollow aortic model, and we mark accordingly the origin of the visceral vessels. Then we remove the model out of it, and then we measure the origins, and we cut the fabric. Then we reinforce the special wires around the fenestration, and we start the implantation of the stent graft in the typical way. Here you can see it. We do this on a back table while the anesthesiologist and the nurses are preparing the patients. You can see here live the fenestration marker placed on the aorta, and you can see here after cutting the fabric, we have taken here the tip of the V18 wire. We placed around the fenestration, and then with a suture, we suture the fenestration. Here you can see our first case that we have successfully treated, and then we have published. Here you can see the second case. Basically, we need approximately 6 hours from the moment we diagnose the pathology till we have the model in our hands, and we need then 1 hour of sterilization time. Steam pressure we use in order to get the model sterile in our table. So basically, this procedure is is suitable for patients that are hemodynamically stable. If the patient are not hemodynamically stable, we need to think of other methods. Here you can see we have used the Valiant Captivia closed web. Closed web, that's important to perform our stent grafts. We can use the Etibon 6-0 suture to mark the fenestration and reinforce the fenestration. As I show you, the tip of the V18 wire for the fenestration, and we always use the rifampicin solution to diminish the infection. You can see here we also use the reducing ties. This is very important, otherwise you cannot manipulate your graft in the aorta, you cannot have accuracy for it while the positioning of the stent graft. So you can see here the grafts that we have used. I told you most of them were Valiant Captivia closed web, but we also used an aortic Unilac from Endurant. And we created 71 fenestration in our cohort, and we used in 14 cases a distal component, two in Endurant, 11 Gore grafts, and also a thoracic dissection in two thoracoabdominal type 3 cases. We looked at that after we gathered these 19 patients at the difference between the manufacturing time using the 3D aortic model and without using the 3D model. And you can see here we have a tremendous difference in the manufacturing time. 54 minutes without the 3D aortic models and 109 minutes. So basically it's almost 50 minutes of reduction in the manufacturing time using the 3D model, which is tremendous if you think of these patients. Here you can see basically how we implant. After we perform the fenestration, we place the graft under X-rays to look at the position and to look at the markers around the fenestration. Then we have the reducing ties. Then we turn the graft freely to see how it does it influence the position of the renal fenestration in a relationship to the other markers. Then we mark the visceral vessel previously. We introduce the graft inside the body. We have an AP to mark the celiac trunk, the SMA, the left and right renal. Then position look from a lateral view again to have the position of the SMA. Main celiac trunk, and then you can see here we deploy the graft only partially below the SMA, and then we come from above. We use the left brachial access, and sometimes it's so easy that with the supracore wire, the fenestration is being immediately cannulated. You can see here the SMA. You can see here deployment of the stent. You can see here the right renal artery, again the celiac trunk. And you can see very good results without endoleak. We perform most of those or all of those procedure in general anesthesia when feasible impergutaneous access. You can see the mean procedure time. It's not longer than with the industry produced stent grafts. Median it's 3 hours of those procedure with an almost 1 hour of X-ray time. You can use the different stent grafts as bridging stents. Physician-modified fenestration does not forbid you to use anything. See the patients who are on the ICU for median 2.8 days. Hospital stay 17 days. We have within 30 days no death. We have two spinal cord ischemia reversible, one renal failure due to early occlusion, which we treated, and we have very good results. Excess complication as usually, and we have one A endoleak and one Y in C endoleak and type 2 endoleak. Two reintervention, which was a recanalization previously, occluded renal artery and one coil of aneurysm sac. We follow those patients and we have a mean follow-up of 13.8 months. We have one death at 1 year due to non-aneurysm related due to bone TFC, further type 1C and type 2 endoleak, which we treated the 1C endoleak, and we got one renal occlusion follow-up, which we successfully recanalized. So as I can conclude saying that 3D printing allows us to manufacture a patient-specific device, which can be a treatment option for complex paravisceral thoracoabdominal aortic pathology, and this leads to a significant reduction in planning and manufacturing time and potentially increasing the accuracy of our stent grafts. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Des questions, Eric?
Any question?
In English or in French?
Well, en français, ça va, ça
in
va.
In German?
German, no.
That's for steady patients, as you said, without any acute emergency. Homemade show that 1 millimeter doesn't make much difference since you can adjust your window, the fenestration. It's a very modern technique and reassuring for the clinician, but you are still obliged when inserting the stent. You always must have to adapt the rotation. So, I mean, you have to adjust things, of course, to comply with the patient's anatomy. And I'm not sure you can have the forostium outside the stent. Answer. I mean, people keep asking me this question, but we have looked at the patients and at the model. In our cases, the 13 of them, we have never had any problem in placing, adjusting the fenestration. We always found the right means to do so without destroying the stent struts. And I don't know, it's because our series has not enough cases, but we have never had such problems. I'm really quite impressed by the quality of the suture, of the fenestration sheath. Well, it's a new development, you know, and with my first stent, it wasn't that good, but we had more confidence now, and I feel more at ease, and it works much better, you know. It's a matter, it's a kind of learning confidence curve. And I must also add that we use very short models, and if there are some angulations in the aorta, they can be taken on board, you know, and the fenestration can be well placed to avoid any issue. And if you try to cannulate a fenestration, the guide wire that is being used, the soft tip guide wire, goes where it has to go without any effort. And it's huge for us. Dominique, good morning and congratulations. It's just great. Now, when it comes to Vastutech endovascular stents, we've been using these fenestrated devices for years. So, it's quite interesting. Additional remark, upstream, upward catheter introduction or insertion is a good solution. Makes it easy for the guide wire to be inserted. Another point, some prostheses, some grafts do not have any stent. That means in such cases, there is no impingement issue. And lastly, may I ask one question? How do you compact the prosthesis inside the guide. Yes, indeed, there are several techniques, several available techniques that are very well described in literature. I haven't had time to show it to you today, but we do take a thread around the prosthesis. Yeah, we do know that. But I had the feeling you had a rigid guide inside. That's a reducing ties, we call it. It's a Vicryl made. It's very well known. And we take two stents, one close to the other. Let me show you. That may be easier to grasp. Here it is. We take this stent, we do a suture, and then we have a knot. It's a very short knot, and then we do the overlapping, and it overlaps. You can see the guide here. It's a guide wire. Et on and les petits nœuds en fait ce les petites anses se chevauchent.
Écrire, c'est pas des.
We did that ourselves and it's some other colleagues do the same and some do puncture the prosthesis with a long needle. That you use for CSF drainage, and they use this for guide introduction. In our case, we do the suture and then we insert the guide.
Vous avez des tibranches?
Excusez-moi.
Est-ce que vous avez en stock des tibranches?
Have you got the T-branches available? Yes, we do. And we do use a lot of T-branches for emergency. When are you going to when do you opt for T-branches? When do you opt for homemade? And what do you privilege? If it's T-branch, we do stick to T-branch. But T-branch means you need a lot of space, so to speak, for branches to unroll or to be deployed. And sometimes you may not have enough space for the branches to be deployed. This is why we can opt for the second alternative. Congratulations for your presentation. It's highly interesting. I've got two questions. First question, one of the limitations of the fenestrated technique is the angulation at between thoracic and abdominal aorta, for instance, which means that when the prosthesis is delivered, the windows of fenestration may be ill-positioned. Did you decide not to trespass a kind of glass ceiling concerning the available techniques you are using? And is there any extra cost to the use of your technique? I'm not talking about the 3D printing machine, but printing system, but. Well, let me start with the additional cost. We have a university lab with a 3D printer. I do work with an engineer. This engineer has prepared the 3D planning. And in fact, we pay for the materials, the resins, which are biocompatible, that are used for teeth prosthesis. That's the only additional cost. Now, next question, that was about angulation. And that we have opted for a short device in order to avoid the angulation problem. With renal arteries, things are a bit tricky, but if the And the moot point may be the graft insertion. If the graft doesn't take the bend, so to speak, then it won't work. I must say that so far it's worked quite well, thanks to our homemade system. But our series is a small series, only 13 cases.
Merci.
Merci beaucoup.